Hello and welcome to The Eye. I'm your host Akivito. Today, in the special edition of The Eye, we will cover the most burning issue that has caught the attention of not only the Northeast but also the rest of the country, the Assam-Mizoram border row. Border disputes in the Northeast region is an issue that is recurring in nature and have been a major bone of contention over a large period of time. But the incidents that have taken place over the past few days have given another repugnant facet to it. Tensions arose on the 25th of July in the Kachar and Hailakandi districts of Assam that shares a boundary with Mizoram's Kolasib district. With the two states defending their actions, the incident that took place have taken the lives of five Jawans and one civilian from the Assam police and have left many Jawans and civilians from both states injured and in need of medical care. In the Parliament, Minister of State for Home Affairs, Nityanand Rai, informed that with regard to interstate border disputes, the centre could only act as a facilitator and that the states involved in such disputes should work in cooperation to try and arrive at an amicable solution. Today in this regard, Hornbill TV had an exclusive interview with Mizoram's Political Affairs Committee member, Mr. TBC Lalveng Chunga. Let's have a look.
Thanks for joining us at Hornbill TV. We are glad that you're here and, you know, hopefully shed some light on the Assam-Mizoram border issue that's been going on and the recent incident on July 26, which has, you know, captured, you know, either both states also in different lights to not only the northeastern states, but also to the rest of the country and the media and, you know, even the center now. So, thanks for joining us. So we will just get, you know, straight to the point. What exactly happened on July 26, as per your knowledge and sources? July 26, how did, what exactly incited the incident?
Actually, the day that the incident happened, it was a series of events which has led up to it. The escalation of the situation, the tense situation which is coming up, was not just on 26th of July. Let me clarify in a short period, that is on 30th of June, when Mizoram was celebrating the agreement signed between the MOU signed between the Indian government and the MNF. And while we celebrated, there are some officials, government officials and police has intruded into Mizoram territory, which is nearby Vairengte. We called it as Aitlang. And destroyed some of the crops and the farm fields over there. And a few policemen were sent over there, which were outnumbered by the Assam police. And then they removed all the temporary sect they had made over there. And then the day after, in the social media, there's come up a lot of viral videos, which, you know, name calling and bullshitting the Mizoram policemen over there. So already attends the situation, we all know it has been since a long time. And after 2 days, there was the intervention of the central government, both the chief secretary were called to New Delhi for a talk.
Okay.
On the 9th of July, there was a talk. On the 10th of July, again, a transgression attempt by the Assam officials with the policemen come on the other side, on the north side of the earlier, which you call it a Borchep village. It's a village. And they're constructing a new road over there and then destroying the fields and all the Arakanat saplings and all those things. And the locals fight back over there. And the Mizoram police also reached there instantly. Thereafter, although we have been pushed back inside our own territory, no affirmative action was taken, even though a talk was held a day earlier. So maintaining status quo, which was which has been in force since 1994, okay, has been breached several times by the Assam government. On 10th, thereafter, there was a clash and there's a lot of commotion between both the states. And since we came to know that on the 24th of July, the Home Minister, Union Home Minister, is coming to Shillong and calling all the NIDA CMs and then sorting out to be sorting out these boundary disputes between the states and before the upcoming Independence Day. So we are waiting for that. But on 24th, when the meeting was held and both sides has come back on Saturday, that meeting was held at the 5 p.m. So no actual clear solution was taken. But we all know that what has transpired after that. On Monday, that is on 26th of June, a group of policemen, armed policemen with heavily armed, around 200 policemen, came inside the Mizoram on the main, our own international national highway we had, which is connecting to the rest of India.
Right.
They came inside with a full force, even with ambulance and the local population of the nearby village, Lailapur. Mm-hmm. And there was last year, as I just need to go back a little bit earlier, and last year on October, there was the same problem happened on the other side. And thereby the central intervened and then put a central CRPF in the buffer zone, mm-hmm. which both of them are supposed to cross it. Mm-hmm. And on that day, when the armed police, of a strong armed police, heavily armed, came with their vehicles, with an ambulance, with the local population over there, they ran over the central police force with a little mm-hmm. resistance. And then marched towards the Mizoram side, which is the Varangte, what do you call it, auto rickshaw stand over there, inside Mizoram. Mm-hmm. We had a police outpost over there. And they took control of it, and then they took over the Mizoram outpost over there, mm-hmm. and then threatening the local population over there. The Varangte people went over there and demanded a retreat of the Assam police, which illegally came inside with a force, with threatening and intimidating all those things. So there's a lot of commotion ongoing over there. We are all seeing through the social medias and the updates and the online and all these things. And there was a lot of pushing around, and the Assam police started firing this thing, what do you call it, a smoke bomb, a tear gas to disperse the public. Mm-hmm. And there was a talk ongoing between the SP of both Balasi District SP and the Kachar District SP. We were in talks in between that post of the Assam police and the Mizo. And while that, there's a Mizo couple who were returning with their new vehicles purchased. They were attacked by the mob, and as per the video evidence available throughout this thing, so the policemen were also included in that attack. Mm-hmm. And then they smashed their car, and then they actually brutally, you know, knocking down the couples also. Yeah. When those couple reached Mizoram side, mm-hmm. So the already angry mob, the already angry people, tried to push further back there towards the Assam side. And at that point of time, I don't know, it was either intentional or in a little bit of confusion or something like that. Fire started from the Assam side, as it is clearly evident in both from the Assam police side, the video is available, who started the firing first, and then from the Mizo also. It was a live coverage at that time. Mm-hmm. So a fire started. I don't know which towards the aim. We have three injured civilians over there at that time. I don't know who did that, who took that first shot. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, the Mizo policemen, who were fewer in numbers, okay. But they are also duty bound to protect their people. Mm. Law and order is a state situation. They come inside our own territory, creating ruckus, having a problem. So they started retaliating back.
Okay.
And just after a few minutes or so, they retreated back and the firing stops. Mm-hmm. And that's all happened on that day.
Mm. And what is exactly the role of the CRPF in the border area? Are they actually manning the situation there the way they're supposed to be, or is there some, again, tussle over there between, you know, CRPF is taking Assam side more in, you know, handling the situation, or Mizoram side more in handling this situation?
It is very unfortunate to say that being a neutralizer over there, being posted over there with the responsibility, if they could not stop it, okay, if example, if they are overrun, for example, a huge number of police has come towards those passing through that gate, mm-hmm. or the duty post,
right.
They should have informed the state government. Well, the state government could have, you know, take to tackle the situation, they could have better take stock of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
But they were not either informed. But it has come to the light of the local population over there staying at a wiring town. They went over there to take stock of the situation. That's the first problem which arises.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of settling, you know, it's a, in India, it's a union of states. Law and order is a state subject. If one state police, law and order, peacekeeper are going to across the border, they need to take official permission from the other administration.
Mm-hmm.
That was not duly taken, first of all. They ignore all the formalities. They come inside, started threatening, took over the police outpost, and which made them more angrier.
Mm.
And already the outnumbered policemen were posted there. They are also duty bound.
Mm-hmm.
They have to take reaction when their people are being attacked. That's the result of it. So I can say that the CRPF, which are being stationed, or SSB on the other, Assam side,
mm-hmm.
it's their duty to stop there and then. But they failed to do so.
On another note, this border issues with almost all northeastern states that Assam has, it has a lot of history, and one needs to study the history behind it. But in regard to Mizoram and Assam, with the, you know, notifications of 1875 and 1933, and it is not a secret that, you know, Mizoram takes the notification of 1875 better than the 1933 one, because they were not confronted or, you know, spoken with about this demarcation. So can you shed some light on that as well?
Yeah, on a short note, we can say that when the British officially took over Mizoram at the time of the Lusai Hills, as they call it, so now actually there was an attack from the Mizoram side, the Lusai district side, to protect their land, their so-called ancestral land, because the British East India Company has been expanding their occupation for the tea garden and all these things. So they have been pushed back already at that time. And then out of many of the inner line reserve which they have created, only 1850 and 1875 are agreed
mm-hmm.
by the Mizo, the representative of the Mizo chiefs. So after that, the British has taken another stance and, you know, decreasing the size of the inner line reserve area towards Mizoram in 1904, 1912, okay, and 1930, 31, 33. Which has been notified using the official notification of 1933, which Assam is being claimed as a constitutional boundary. The mistake is that we all in Mizoram, including us, even in the opposition party, all political parties, all the NGOs, even the government, the cabinet decision, a resolution has been made that the boundary, the area should be included and start from the northern boundary of Mizoram should start from the inner line reserve area. And let me say, clarify on that thing a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
After India got independence, when Mizoram was upgraded to district council in the under the Assam states, Assam province, it was very clear that this inner line reserve forest area of 509 square miles, which the British has carved out of that in 1875 notification, a lot of those things has been encroached by the Assam side. Mm-hmm. Even though they have approached, it's a reserve forest, the text they have collected from inner line reserve forest has been given back to the district council of Mizoram 70%. Only 30% had been retained by the Assam at that time.
Mm-hmm.
After Mizoram became 1971, NIERA Act, noticed an area reorganization of 1971, which subsequently uses the previous boundary of the Lusai Hills district area. It is increasing one by one after 1986, when we met the peace accord with the government of India.
Mm-hmm.
And the Assam took stand as 1933 should be made a legal constitutional boundary. But let me clarify one thing on that thing, because the constitutional boundary, which as they claim, or if you look at the Survey of India repository, if you check it, none of the maps or the toposites which were available in the northern areas of Mizoram were neither verified nor by Mizoram nor Assam,
mm-hmm.
or it was also clearly remarked that ground verification had not been done. So basically, it is a high time that you need to settle on the table on a serious matter. Political will is required.
Mm-hmm.
We stand, we can say that whether they claim it 1933 or not, we do claim it's our ancestral land, that is 1875 in our land reserve forest notification is what we claim and what we are stood for.
Sir, you know, not just bordering with Assam and Mizoram, but Bangladesh, we have Bangladesh as well. So many are claiming it to be an issue of migrants that are coming in. And, you know, even the videos have also proven that the language that, you know, they are speaking at the border is not exactly, you know, the Assamese or the Mizo, or, you know, it is Bangladesh. So would you also say that most of the reason, I mean, a majority, high percentage would be because of the immigrants?
Yes, the current situation, the escalation of the current situation, which led to our current scenario, mm-hmm. happened, I can surely say that just because of political vote banks with the immigration issue, illegal immigration, immigrants issue. Because if you see, day before yesterday, when Honorable CM of Assam, Mr. Himanta Biswa Sarma, has made a statement in front of the media, he said that their job is to protect the forest reserve, not the land. Mm. It's the rights of the central government. If the central government says so, we'll return it back to the Mizoram. That's what he claimed. Because he claimed to be the protector of the reserved area, reserved forest. But in reality, if you look at the village forest census of Assam, of the latest, you could see that in 1983, there were roughly less than 100 settlements in that area of the inner line reserve forest. But right now, they have increased more than 10 folds of that thing in three boundary districts of Hailakandi, Karimganj, and this thing. Mm-hmm. So as per the PM Vision report of 2017, which was later retracted, which was later said as unauthentic or something like that, the Prime Minister Vision report of 2017 clearly stated that 98% of Hailakandi people are illegal immigrants. Mm-hmm. So it may not be 98%, but you could securely say that a lot of this problem has come because of the vote bank politics. You can see in the last year election and the run-up to this thing, and even after this, the current scenario which I've been running up to, because none of the original Assamese inhabitants, even the Kachari in the Kachar district, mm-hmm. they have been outnumbered already.
Right.
To appease these people, I don't know, the political, you know, parties today are taking advantage of that, mm-hmm. making the scenario more volatile or more vulnerable to mm-hmm. ethnic problem.
Coming back to this problem, vote banks, and, you know, Home Minister has said that by 2024, in the next general elections, that northeastern states should settle their border disputes with Assam. Now, you know, in regard to that, if he has directed this notice to all the states, do you think it's possible by then that such a big issue like this would be settled by 2024 general elections?
It's highly unlikely if you look at the way things are being handled by the central government, because it needs a political will. It's not a talk. You should walk the talk if you would like to, because the day just after the Union Home Minister has, mm-hmm. you know, held a talks with all the chief ministers of the northeastern states, a day after, the thing has erupted.
Do you think all these incidents that have happened in the northeast with Assam regarding border issues are connected? I mean, is the timing just so coincidental, or is there a certain, you know, manipulative perspective of the Assamese government that it is all happening at the same time with all the most of the northeastern states?
One thing is, obviously boundary is a political issue. So every political party should have, you know, make it as an agenda to clarify or to make a settlement out of this problem. But the current scenario as we face is the self-centering chief minister of Himanta, who has been made the convener of the NIDA, mm-hmm. using the NIDA to flex his muscle in the central India. Because in the poll-bound Assam in last year also, what he had made promise using the distinct electoral politics also, he made it clear that CAA, he welcomed it. NRC, he welcomed it. But he is deferring the NRC. After 19 lakhs when more than 19 lakhs have been identified lastly as the number of our outlawed in the NRC,
mm-hmm.
instead of pushing back or instead of putting, you know, into a detention center, he takes sides of a religious color. So the number of people, especially the Bengali Hindu who has come inside this thing, who were enlisted in the NRC,
mm-hmm.
He took stock of the situation, and as per rumors over here, which is mongering around the mm-hmm. northern boundary of Mizoram, mm-hmm. it is said that the Assam government is trying to create a new districts to settle those people who are being not included in the NRC.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, it's a political propaganda, we can say it. But since it is not only with Mizoram, we can safely say that he wants to achieve his own political propaganda. He wants to achieve his own political gains through flexes muscle in the central India. As of now, we know that Hemantaji, he is a honorable chief minister of Assam, is a big person in the central BJP leadership also. His name has become a big one in the central BJP leadership.
Mm-hmm.
And we all know that. And right now, I also would like to urge each mm-hmm. and every chief minister of the leader,
mm-hmm.
instead of creating an EDA to make an emperor out of the Northeastern sisterly states, you can simply join the NDA. From the NDA itself, you still can assert the support and the thing you require from the central government by creating Northeastern Democratic Alliance, which is under the umbrella of the NDA, mm-hmm. creating a subgroup. You are giving a power to the current chief minister of Himanta, which mm-hmm. will be very, very costly to me, I think, and
okay.
which will create a lot of problem for us in the future.
So would you say it's a well-meticulated plan of the Assam government to just infiltrate in these northeastern states and create, you know, these settlements of people who are not included in the NRC?
That's one of the propaganda mm-hmm. which is circling around.
Mm-hmm.
It might be, but nonetheless, I would like to state that despite speaking all those things,
mm-hmm.
what we need to understand is we have maintained a status quo.
Yes.
Okay, with Assam and Arunachal, there is an ongoing Supreme Court cases. Okay,
mm-hmm.
Himanta has said that with Mizoram also, he would file a lawsuit in the Supreme Court.
As with Nagaland as well, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that today it's still not solved.
Mm-hmm.
So boundary issue is a political issue. It requires the, you know, the sacrifice and the will, the need of the this thing, the political leadership.
Mm.
But as of today, what we see, it is just doing not, you know, settling out the dispute. Instead, they are just trying to flare up the issue for their own political gain mm. instead of trying to achieve amicable solution. That's what I see.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever may be the reason behind that thing, but what I see from the general public, what I wish them to see is that we should refrain, we should show some refrain from this kind of political gimmicks given by the politicians.
Mm-hmm. And coming to this amicable solution today, the chief secretaries, as you know, we all know that they're having a meeting with the center, with the Union Home Secretary. Now, do you have any word on that, or what is... it got postponed and everything with the Union Home Secretary, but I think I am told that the Chief Secretary of Mizoram has met Union Home Secretary, Mr. Ajay Balla. So have you had any word or have you heard anything on the development, on what they spoke? Is there any settlement that's going to come in before it escalates?
Not yet till now,
mm-hmm.
but you see, on the 9th of July, there was a meeting already
mm-hmm.
with the Union Home Secretary. What is the outcome? We all know that.
Mm-hmm.
And this one also, without the political leaders who are at the helms of the states, if they are not unwilling to discuss, if they are unwilling to sit on the table, then what will be the outcome? They are just a bureaucrats, okay?
Mm-hmm.
They are not the authorization, or they don't have a public mandate to,
mm-hmm.
you know, settle out that thing. So I don't hope that much high, but the need of the hour is to de-escalate the situation. But it seems, well, the Mizoram chief minister in his Twitter tweeted that he urges people to, you know, maintain peaceful and to maintain peace among these, with regards to the current scenario. Well, Assam Chief Minister, Mr. Himanta Biswa Sarma, has been, you know, circulating a little bit of, you know, unverified videos circling around and calling And in his even in his press conference, he clearly stated that trying to, you know, rallying 4,000 commandos at the border again,
right, sir,
and giving extra salary for the policemen who are posted there at the border. Those were just provocative, actually. It is not settling things down. It is not de-escalating things down. Mm-hmm. The way he has been addressing the media and to the public, even the MP of Kachar, Mr. Dr. Rajbar, in his tweet also, sarcastically, he is tweeting some images of all photographs available on the internet and taking the comments on a sarcastic manner. So basically, the willingness of the politician is a little bit grim to me, I think. So instead of dousing the fire, we are adding fuel to the fire as of now, as I see. Because the problem was a boundary dispute. Okay, the initiation was might be because of the boundary dispute, but the problem which we had faced, unprecedented and unfortunate incident on 26th of July, was clearly within Mizoram boundary. They come and cross Mizos and create ruckus, took control over our police and attacking and threatening and brutally, you know, had beaten even into 2017 when there was a problem in the Bairabi area of Mamit district. Or even a journalist, Miss Emmy Lobe, which is available all around the web, she was beaten brutally. That's this style of functioning. This style of functioning, crossing the already status quo and, you know, the buffer zone into others' territory, and later on claim that I am a victim. That is very wrong. If you are trying, your house is being burning, and what will you do? You have to save your child, you have to save your family. So you will have to pick up whatever tools you have. You have to fight it back. That's what we had done.
You know, on that note, one last question also, like, Mr. Himanta Biswa has directed that, again, according to the Assam government, that to follow a blockade of National Highway 306. And how is, you know, how, again, won't that be another insightful thing for, you know, provocating violence? And is it revengeful of Assam to do that, to close down, you know, all economic transportations for and essential commodities to Mizoram? Last year, I think it happened for 12 days. And this time again, it's happening. So how is Mizoram going to deal with this? How are they going to tackle this problem?
See, I'm deeply saddened by the demise of six police personnel from the Assam side. And my condolences to the bereaved families also. But as you said, blocking the national highway and disrupting the rail network to Mizoram, which our Home Secretary, Mizoram's Home Secretary, had written to the Union Home Secretary today with regards to that one also. They resort to this tactic each time there is a problem flare up in and around the border. National highway is the property of government of India. It's not the property of Assam. And at the time when we bought from the sites in the Assamese, the original inhabitants of Assamese and the Mizos were residing over here, we don't have a problem at all. We are actually giving a shelter to each other across the border as of we speak right now also. They are giving a shelter to the Mizos who are stranded over on the Assam side, and they are giving a protection to the laborers or truck drivers or something like that who are stranded over here. There is no problem. Actually, the problem is with the authority. We need to go beyond this thing, blockage and this thing, you know, maintaining a hypothetical and hypocrisy showing among the media, saying that we will not do any economic blockage and all these things. And an hour after that, the same thing he has said he would not do has been happened, and he could not control it. He is the one who cannot control law and order in the state. We are the one who has been controlling. The firing happened. It was unfortunate. It was very tragic. And I can say that one. I'm very sorry for the bereaved family also. But let me clarify that if you put on his hands in a fire, he will get burned, obviously. He don't care about the jawans, the policemen, or the civilian who are residing over there. He just used them as a pawn to make himself an emperor. That is what I am seeing. Irresponsible and provocative speech continuation of Assam Chief Minister will seriously lead to a lot bigger problem than it is we face today.
All right, sir. Thank you so much for speaking to us. Really appreciate it. Hornbill TV really appreciates that you've spared your time.
And that was Mr. Lalvin Chunga, Political Affairs Committee Member, Mizoram, speaking to Hornbill TV's anchor, Esther. Today, the Union Home Secretary, Ajay Balla, had a meeting with the Chief Secretaries and DGPs of both Assam and Mizoram in regard to assess the volatile border situation between the two states. Stay tuned with Hornbill TV for more updates on this. And this was all for The Eye. Stay tuned.